Good evening, everyone, and welcome to church this evening. It's great to see you here this evening for our service tonight. As we gather together, as we come to praise our great God, let me read a verse from Colossians. It's from Colossians chapter 3, verse 16. It even incorporates the Trinity in there. So, let the message of Christ dwell among you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom, through psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts. Let's do exactly that now as we praise our great God together. Please stand.
Is raising hell. praising God so loved the world.
Please take a seat.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to St. Phil's Night Church. It's so good to see you all here. My name's Sarah. I'm a regular at the service, and I love coming along and being part of this community. That last song is so catchy and it gets stuck in my head all week, but it's so good to have those words stuck in my head. So how good is it that, you know, God so loves us, that he sent his only son for us, and I hope it gets stuck in your head too, all through the week. Before we continue, I'd just like to pray for us before we continue the service. Dear loving Father, thank you that we can gather together to worship and to serve and to learn more about you. Thank you that your love is so great that you gave your son Jesus to lay down his life so that we could be in relationship with you. Please cast out our fears and distractions and open our hearts to the work of the Holy Spirit tonight. Amen. Well, a big, special, warm welcome to anyone who's visiting. You might be new, you might be passing through, even if you've been here for 50 years. We're so glad that you're here tonight and that we can share this time together. So hopefully we can mingle during and after the service and get to know you better. So you might have a service outline, just gives you a rundown of what's going on today in this service. But church is so much more than what's in the service sheet. It can't contain church, you know. It's more than this building, it's more than the next hour of a service. It's about fellowship, Christian believers coming together, encouraging each other, supporting each other, but also welcoming in the rest of the world to come and be part of this fellowship. It's also about fellowshipping with God. So we pray, which is speaking to God. We also hear from God through his word. So we explore his word through the sermon and through the readings. And we also have a time of worshiping through song, where we honour and give thanks to our God. So church is such a beautiful thing, and I'm so glad to be a part of it, and I hope you are too. So another really important part of church is confession, and that's a time when we humble ourselves before God. And as it says in Daniel, which will come up on the screen, so chapter 9, verses 9 to 10, "The Lord our God is merciful and forgiving, even though we have rebelled against him. We have not obeyed the Lord our God or kept the laws he gave us through his servants, the prophets." We're now going to say these words together, so I encourage you to say them along with me. And whether you're speaking out loud or just reading it in your mind, please pay attention to these words because they're very powerful. O Lord our God, you know us better than we know ourselves. As we come before you now, believers and doubters alike, we all share a deep need, for we are all lost without your grace. Search us, O God, and know our hearts. Test us and know our troubled thoughts. Give us true repentance. Forgive us all our wrongs. Transform us by your Spirit to live for you each day, to learn to serve each other, and through the grace of Jesus Christ our Lord, to come at last to heaven. Amen. I'd just like to invite Josh to come and share general prayers.
Thank you, Sarah. Good evening, everyone. My name is Josh. I'm one of the student ministers here. And we have the great joy now praying together to our Heavenly Father. So please join with me as I lead us in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you that we are able to gather as your people here tonight. And Father, as we come to continue in our sermon series in the Trinity, we're reminded in your word, the scriptures, that your Son, Jesus, is the radiance of your glory and the exact representation of your being, sustaining all things by his powerful word, and that he now reigns with you in heaven. Father, we pray as we learn more about your Son, as we learn more about his supremacy, as we learn more about who he is and what he has done for us, that we would be truly struck, that we would marvel at his glory, and that we would be transformed and changed to love and serve him as King and Lord, as well as our Saviour. Father, we pray that our community here at St. Phil's, as well as at St. Mark's, would be a community marked by being centred on Jesus in all things, corporally as one body here, but also in our daily lives. Father, we pray that we would continue to grow as followers of Jesus, that we would be marked as a community known by grace and transformed by grace in the way in which we live. Father, help us to continue to grow in the way we read your word regularly, if not daily. Please help us to continue to grow in our prayerfulness with one another as well as on our own. Father, help us to continue to be generous with the things that you so richly bless us with and lavish on us. Father, please help us to continue to grow in our hearts, desires, and affections for the risen Lord Jesus in all that we do. Father, we also want to give you thanks for the various parachurch organizations and ministries, but particularly, Lord, to bring before you today AFES ministry. Father, thank you that you continue to use university ministry groups on campuses all throughout Australia and indeed throughout the world to faithfully and boldly proclaim Jesus' Lordship. We know, Father, that you bring many, many people from nations all throughout the world to university campuses right across Australia. And we ask, Lord, as you bring the nations here, that many of them who may for the first time ever actually hear the gospel, that you would open their eyes and their ears and soften their hearts so that they would know Jesus as their King and Lord as well as their Savior. We give you thanks, Lord, also for Sandra, who is joining us tonight. Thank you for her ministry with AFES as well as with the UNSW campus with CBS. We ask, Lord, that you would strengthen her and enable her to continue to faithfully serve you, to serve your people, and to be used by you so that you may magnify the radiance of the glory of your Son. Father, we also pray for the upcoming federal election, as well as for generally our local, state, and federal governments. Father, we know that you give us governments and authorities to lead us well, to ensure that there is order rather than chaos, and to enable human flourishing. Father, we ask that with our government officials and our leaders, that you would be working in them so that they would grow in their love for people, that they would grow in servant-heartedness, particularly for the downtrodden and the marginalized, for those who are ostracized, and for those who do not have a voice. Father, we pray that in these men and women, you would be growing a government at all various levels that continues to seek the good of all and the good of society, particularly those who are on the margins. And we ask, Lord, for wisdom for us as we continue to weigh up our decision with the upcoming federal election. We pray for both Scott Morrison and Anthony Albanese, as well as other minor party leaders, that they would be gracious in the way that they interact with one another. And Father, we pray that we would continue to wrestle with what it looks like to serve you in this way. Father, we also pray for our wider community. We know that the world is aching to know Jesus as we were designed to be in relationship with you. So Father, we pray for Eastwood, Ermington, and a little bit more, that you would be bringing spiritual revival, that people would come to know Jesus. Father, we pray that we would be used as your ambassadors to go out and boldly proclaim the truths that have shaped and transformed our own lives as we pray, Lord, that you would awaken people. Father, as we continue in our service tonight, we ask that you would help quieten our hearts and our minds so that we can listen and sit under your word and its authority. We know that your word is sharper than any double-edged sword. So, Father, we ask that by your word and your spirit, you'd be helping us to grow in our love and our knowledge as well as in our response to Jesus. And Father, we also pray for our wider world. We know that many Christians throughout the world are persecuted for their faith. And so, Father, we pray that you would strengthen their resolve in their faithfulness and their boldness in proclaiming Jesus. We pray, Lord, that we too would be impacted by their faithful witness and recognize that your gospel is powerful, it is bold, it is transformative. And Father, we pray that it would continue to go out and reach many peoples, particularly people groups that have little or no access to the gospel. Father, may you raise up from this very congregation, as well as throughout our church at St. Phil's and St. Mark's and beyond, many more gospel workers and many more people that can go out into the harvest, that you would be bringing many more people into your glorious and eternal kingdom in your Son. Father, we pray that in all these things, you'll be at work for the glory of yourself as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen. Well, we are going to say now the Lord's Prayer. This is the prayer that Jesus himself gave us as his followers to say. So the words will appear on the screen, and I'd love for you to join with me together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We're now going to go to our engaged spot this week.
Thanks, Josh. Evening, everyone. How exciting is to be here tonight. Wonderful to see you all, upstairs and downstairs. I've just got a few things. I want to introduce you to our guest tonight in a little while. Just let me give a few things to your attention. Firstly, as you came in, you may not have noticed it, but there is a petition there. We don't put these out very lightly or unthoughtfully. This is a petition to the members of the Legislative Council of New South Wales against the Voluntary Assisted Dying Bill. There are good reasons for this, and I think if you're informed about it, you would know. But if you're not informed, let me encourage you to get informed about it. We have a wonderful team in the diocese. One of our bishops has been putting a lot of work into this, liaising with the government, trying to get wording better and amendments working, but they haven't really worked well. And so his suggestion for our diocese is to actually consider, for Christians to consider petitioning against the bill completely because of the way it stands at the moment. Now, you may have different views on that. I've formed a view on it based on people who know more than me, so I'd go that way. So you may feel that way as well, but that petition is going to be there for the next 3 weeks. Don't sign it uninformed, but have a think about it or start your own petition. But we'll put this one in the front foyer if you want to. They ask for all your details. But anyway, it will be sent into the diocese in about 3 weeks. The other thing is a little photo for you. Sometimes our gates are left open. I know this is a very sort of droll sort of announcement, but if you see a gate left open, because of the rain, the hinges don't always close properly, and sometimes people tie them open. We don't want that happening. I know there's generally no little kids here, but we want to keep a safe place anyway. We're trying to keep people out, right? Just keep people out, lock them. If you see an open gate, could you just swing it shut? That'd be great, and don't prop them open. Enough said? Right, good. Let's move on. Hey, tomorrow's pretty exciting. I'm just excited because the marriage course is starting tomorrow night. Is that right, Rod? Tomorrow night. Pray for them over the next seven weeks. Wow, a marriage is really that important? I don't know. Six weeks I could do, but seven, no. It's wonderful. Pray for them. Two of the people helping with that course are Glyn and Anne Henman. I just want to just mention, if you didn't know already, that yesterday, I attended a farewell for Young Life, farewelling Glyn, because he has been their CEO and a member of Young Life, serving with them for 31 years and stepped down only this Friday. Is that right? So, Glyn, I just want to tell you, serving in ministry for 31 years in one organisation is pretty amazing. So I just want to say our prayers are with you, and we pray for whatever God may lead you in the next. It was wonderful to be able to attend that day and to see someone devote, in terms of lifetimes, it's 1.5 generations of serving in an organisation. So please keep praying for Glyn and for the steps that God might lead him in. It was just a privilege to be there. And he'll be at the marriage course on Monday helping run it. Thank you. Wonderful. One more very important thing is that we have a visitor with us tonight. Sandra King has been, Josh has been praying just recently, just then, for her. Sandra's going to share with us a bit about the ministry that she takes part in. And Sandra, let's come on up. Please welcome her. I'm just going to hand over to her. Thank you very much.
Good evening. Hello. It's great to be here. Let me present myself, first of all. See if it can work. Great. Thank you. I'm working with a group called AFES, the Australian Fellowship of Evangelical Students. And that's a national gathering of campuses, Christian groups on campuses around Australia. So it's an Australian-wide organisation. And I'm particularly involved in campus Bible study, which is at University of New South Wales, which is just one of those many groups meeting from around Australia. Let me tell you a bit about my family. First of all, I was adopted by God's grace into his family through Jesus when I was 12 years old. My physical family involves my husband, Paul, and we have three children and a lovely daughter-in-law. Students, why do we do ministry at universities? Some of you here are probably students. You could answer this question for me, but I'll answer it, save time. It's because there are thousands and thousands of university students in Australia, Australian students and international students. And at a time of life where they're asking questions about who they are, they're sort of not going to do what their parents say necessarily anymore. I'm wanting to know what life is about. And we long that they hear about Jesus. And so AFES has a mission statement. I'm going to let you read it for 10 seconds. Hope you can see it. The first thing we do is we pray. And so in prayerful dependence on God, we proclaim Jesus, our marvellous Saviour, on university campuses. And we pray because it's God's work. And I invite you also to be praying for this ministry. And also be praying for your friends. If you have friends who are at university or at university yourself, pray for those round about you that they might come to know the Lord Jesus. And then we talk about evangelism. We long for people to hear about Jesus and give their lives to him. And this evangelism can happen in large groups. This was a mission that happened last year. And in small groups. You know, these small groups, I'm involved in the law faculty. These small groups are open groups for people to come along and open the Bible and discover who Jesus is and how he changes our lives. So in prayerful dependence, we evangelize. We also encourage each other. And that can be in small groups and large groups. We've got our mid-year conference coming up. Sydney Uni has its ANCON. There's different sorts of these conferences around Australia. A great time to dig into God's word and to grow. The theme for our conference coming up is fully known and still loved, about God's love for us. So one of the things I do is I do train. One of my chief roles is to be training people. So I train some of the young grads who are doing 2 years ministry apprentices with us. You may have heard of MTS. AFES organises MTS around Australia so that young grads can find out if they would like to go into ministry or how they can be better serving at their local churches. I have two fabulous Christian women, Winona and also Abby, who I meet with every week. We talk about godliness, how we can be answering questions better, leading people to consider Jesus. And the other part of my role is I meet with some of the female staff in the Sydney region to encourage them and to pray together and talk together about different issues. So Sarah is at Western Sydney University at Penrith. There's Rachel, who is ACU at North Sydney, Wollongong University, EU. That's one of the roles I think I have as an older staff worker. The last thing, so we've talked about prayer and evangelise, encourage, train, and the final thing that AFES does is send. We so much want the whole world to hear about Jesus. And we challenge students, will you go? Will you give up your careers and take the gospel to the nations? The question that challenged me, and I ask this question to students to this day, if Jesus has done so much for you by laying down his life, what would you not do for him out of thankfulness? You've got a card, I hope. Have a look at the back of it. There's some information about me and my family. I'd like to invite you to consider partnering with me either through prayer. Send me an email. I'd love to put you on my prayer list with regular prayer details. Please consider if you'd like to support me financially so I can continue to do this ministry. And finally, let me read this last verse. This verse has been a really important verse for my husband and me. He became a Christian really as a result of Mark's gospel and this verse. Jesus said, "For even the Son of Man came not to be served but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many." And our hope and prayer is that many students will come to know Jesus. Thank you.
Thanks so much for sharing with us, Sandra. Sandra's going to be around tonight, so catch her in a moment. We're going to have a five-minute break. It's a great time to talk to Sandra, find out about what's happening and how you can be involved, or if you want to know more. I think I recognise one of our members in one of those photos. I don't know if you did too. Maybe you talk to Rod and Amanda about what's happening at the marriage course. Maybe you talk to Glenn about what he's doing for the next 31 years. You could talk to Josh and Anna about what's happening at Ermington. It's the time to catch up, and maybe you can just think about ministry and think about what people are doing and how they're serving in church. You'll notice also, if you look around, there's a lot of people away, and this is a recurrent thing at the moment. People are away because of COVID, because of flu, because of they don't know if it's COVID or flu or what it is. So we're going to have months of this. So I just want to thank you, those of you who have been sick, who have been away for a week and then you're back again, sometimes for 2 weeks. Thank you for caring for us by staying away. All right? It's good to keep doing that, but thanks for returning as well. So keep praying for those who are sick on and off. It's just going to be the next few months of that, so let's keep up and keep doing that well. Let's have a five-minute break.
Yeah.
Welcome back, everyone. Good to see everyone enjoying a chat. I'd like to invite everyone to please stand up. So we're about to sing a song, but before that, I'd just like to take a moment to just remind everyone that we have an opportunity to give to the church. It's another way that we can serve the church and partner with the church in serving God and through Christian ministry. And we can do that through giving up the back towards the rear door. There's a tap and go option and also a box that you can put the physical money in. You can also transfer money online however you see fit, if you feel called to do so. And we're just going to say a quick prayer together. So if you would like, please say this along with me. Heavenly Father, help us to give generously from all you have given us for your purposes and for your kingdom. Amen.
You ask my soul.
So we've been doing a series on the Trinity, and last week we looked at God the Father. This week we'll be looking at God the Son. Any guesses what the third one will be? God the Holy Spirit. Yep, yep, nice. So the Trinity is a pretty big topic, and it's such a mysterious thing. It's pretty exciting to learn about. It's one of those things that we can't see the light. Like, there's nothing on earth that compares. And, you know, only God could come up with the Trinity, and only God can pull it off. It's pretty amazing. And so I'm looking forward to hearing the sermon tonight. And before we dive into the Word, I'd just like to pray. Loving Father, thank you for the wonder of the Trinity and the way it's revealed through Scripture. Help us to understand more about your Son Jesus through the passages and prepare our hearts to respond to the Holy Spirit. Amen. I'd like to invite Tim and Amanda to read for us.
The first Bible reading comes from John, chapter 1, verses 1 to 18. That's John, chapter 1, verses 1 to 18. In beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. The true light that gives light to everything was coming into the world. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision or a husband's will, but born of God. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. John testified concerning him. He cried out, saying, "This is the one I spoke about when I said, 'He who comes after me has surpassed me because he was before me.' Out of his fullness we have all received grace in place of grace already given. For the law was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God, but the one and only Son, who is himself God and is in closest relationship with the Father, has made him known."
The second reading is from Galatians chapter 3. So Galatians 3, verses 26 to 4, verse 7. "So in Christ Jesus, you are all children of God through faith. For all of you who were baptized into Christ have clothed yourselves with Christ. There is neither Jew nor Gentile, neither slave nor free, nor is there male and female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. If you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. What I am saying is that as long as an heir is under age, he is no different from a slave, although he owns the whole estate. The heir is subject to guardians and trustees until the time set by his father. So also, when we were under age, we were in slavery under the elemental spiritual forces of the world. But when the set time had fully come, God sent his Son, born of a woman, but under the law, to redeem those under the law, that we might receive adoption to sonship. Because you are his sons, God sent his Spirit, the Spirit of his Son, into our hearts, the Spirit who calls out, 'Abba, Father.' So you are no longer a slave, but God's child. And since you are his child, God has made you also an heir."
Thanks, Tim. Thanks, Amanda. It's good to be here. There's an outline on page 2, if that's helpful. Let me pray as we come to God's Word together. Who else commands all the hosts of heaven? Who else can make every king bow down? What other power can raise the dead? What other name remains undefeated? Who else would offer his only son? Who else invites me to call him Father? Heavenly Father, we come before you tonight under your word, struck by the beauty of how you reveal yourself to us, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, all in an effort to have a relationship with us sinful human beings. We thank you for this, and we pray that you would speak to us tonight in a way that helps us to know you even more deeply as our Father, as our Redeemer, as a Creator, and as our Sustainer. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Time does not exist. Have you heard this week? You've been up on your reading your Sky News. Someone thought this morning I said Sky News. They said, what are you listening to Sky News for? Well, no, Sky News. Scientific news, the big development over the last couple of weeks. You've had to have heard it, right? Time does not exist. Apparently, this is a new thing. The article from Sky News said, time, this is the opening sentence, time may not actually exist. So I've known this for ages because that's why I don't wear a watch. See? Time doesn't exist. The article goes on to say, physics is in crisis. So it's funny because when I was a student studying physics, I was in crisis. So it's good. It's just like payback time. Physics in crisis. Suffer. For the past century or so, we've explained the universe with two wildly successful physical theories, general relativity and quantum mechanics. And if you get that far into the article, you're thinking, I'm out of here. That's it. Physics is in crisis for good reason. They use way too big of words. The article concludes with this statement. We suggest the discovery that time does not exist may have, get this, no direct impact on our lives. There's physics for you, no direct impact on our lives. Even while it propels physics into a new era. So it's funny, you know, physicists are thinking, I almost said psychics. Physicists are thinking, oh, wow, this is exciting, a new era. And we're thinking, oh, it doesn't affect us at all. Physics, the universe, all that sort of stuff. Time does not exist. But that's the sentence that really grabbed me. No direct impact. How many things in life do we not understand and then we come to this conclusion? No direct impact. I don't know how that works. No direct impact. I don't know how that works. I don't understand that. No direct impact. How many times have you walked home from school thinking exactly that? No direct impact. Today had no direct impact on me. This is the world we live in. Unfortunately, it's very easy to people say that about God. And it's very easy for Christians to say that about the Trinity. Because it's a difficult concept. It's something that blows our mind that here is God presenting himself as one in three, and three in one, and one in three. Of the same substance, of three persons in one, indistinct yet distinguished. How is it that we can understand this? Well, no direct impact, right? No, not true. Because the very nature of God describing himself in Trinitarian terms, there's a big word, bigger than a physicist, is because he wants a relationship with us. And therefore, understanding the Trinity has a very much a direct impact on the way we relate to God, on how we relate to God, on who we understand him to be. That's why we're doing it. So I want to encourage you tonight to ask you, plead with you, request that you might stretch your thinking a little bit more wherever you stand with God, a believer, a non-believer, someone on the edge thinking about it. This is worth thinking about because this has a direct impact on your relationship with the Creator and Sustainer of the universe. He has chosen to reveal himself to you and to me in this way. And it seems difficult, but there is a way we can just understand him a little bit more each time we visit this. That's our aim tonight, to understand God as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Tonight we're going to be focusing on the work of the Son, Jesus, because he is God in the flesh. The second person mentioned of the Trinity, the revealing of God himself in our form. God the Creator chose to take on our form, the form of his creation. Why? So through Jesus, we could have a very personal relationship with God himself. Find another religion where the Creator, the Sustainer, the God, the Deity actually wants a personal relationship with you. This is where it's at. This is what it's about. This is why God reveals himself in the flesh. And Jesus, if I can put it crudely, Jesus is all about what God has done. It's what God has done in Jesus that makes him extraordinary. And there are two particular parts about Jesus I want to look at today. We can't cover everything. That's why we do the Trinity series every 2 or 3 years, because we can't cover everything. Here are the two things that I want to talk about tonight briefly. That Jesus was fully God, is fully God, and he was fully human. Fully God and fully human. Let's start with that first one, Jesus, fully God. And I want to encourage you, with topical stuff, you sort of jump around the Bible a bit, but it's good to have the verses in front of you. So if you've got your phone with your Bible on it, or the Bible that's the maroon one in front of you, pull it out, talk to the New Testament towards the last third of the book, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. You'll find John's Gospel there. Anyone got a page number? I've got it here, actually. Look at that. I'm going to look it up, give you time to look it up as well in the maroon Bible. And it's on page 1062. John chapter 1, verse 1, God, fully God, Jesus, here it is. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. And so first of all, you think, well, who is the Word that John is introducing here? And then we get to verse 14, the end of that little section, and here we have who the Word is. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. So John doesn't start his gospel with a story of Jesus being born on earth to Mary. He starts right back at the beginning. In the very beginning was the Word. Word was with God. The Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. The Word who was there in the beginning is Jesus. The Word of God. Verse 3 says this. I still find this one of the most stunning verses in the Bible. Verse 3, John chapter 1, verse 3. Through him, Jesus, the Word, all things were made. And without him, nothing was made that has been made. Because in that verse, it says Jesus is not just the Redeemer of mankind. He is the Creator. You can't distinguish him from the Father in that sense. He was with God in the beginning. The Trinity, in fact, the first person of the Godhead mentioned in the Bible in Genesis chapter 1, verse 2, is the Spirit of God hovering over the waters. They are there in the beginning. 3 in 1, 1 in 3. Jesus, the Redeemer, is also the Creator. If you're a person who likes to cook or dabble in the kitchen, I wonder if you've ever used plain flour instead of self-raising flour. Anyone done that? And when you need to use self-raising, so you can use self-raising flour for pretty much anything, right, with flours involved. But if you need self-raising flour, you can't use plain flour. It doesn't work. It doesn't raise on itself, right? That's self-raising flour. If you ever cooked in the kitchen and used salt instead of sugar, anyone ever done that? I'm surprised at this. What is wrong with you people? It's salt. It's in a different container. I've never done that, I'm just saying. But, you know, if you use salt instead of sugar, disaster. Same the other way around. Put salt in someone's coffee, see how they like it. If you ever put diesel in your car instead of 95 or 98, because it's cheaper, you know, if you ever done that, don't do it. Why? Because it matters, doesn't it? It matters if you use the wrong flour. It matters if you use sugar or salt. It matters if you use diesel or unleaded. It matters. Those things matter. If someone says to you, Jesus may have been God, may not have been God, but he did die for me, he did live a good life, that's enough for me. But I don't know if he was God or not. Well, let me tell you, it does matter. To say that Jesus may or may not be God, it does matter. It matters as a matter of life and death. who Jesus is. It matters that he is God. First of all, because Jesus himself said he was God when he was on earth. And so if Jesus is not God, he's a liar. So everything else we take from him is, we can't be trusted. He's the creator. He was there in the beginning. In our creeds, our statements of faith we say or we sing, we often say those words, he was begotten, not made. Well, that means he was begotten, he was born like we were born, right? So he had that human entrance into the world, but he was not created like we were. We were, Psalm 139, we were created, we were knit together by God in our mother's womb. Jesus was not created. He was born of a woman, but not created. Because he's God. And it matters if we say that he wasn't. The other thing that matters is that if he's not God, he can't do what he claims to have done. Jesus claims to have forgiven us from our sins. He claims to have paid the sacrifice for our sin. He claims to have taken the punishment for our guilt. Now, if he was God, he can do that. He has no sin of his own to pay for. If he's not God, he can't pay for our sin because he's got his own sin to deal with. Talked about this a few weeks ago, right? We needed the perfect sacrifice, and God is the only one who's perfect. If Jesus is not God, he couldn't defeat sin, he couldn't pay for our sin, he couldn't defeat death, he couldn't do those things. Jesus is fully God. He is the Redeemer. He's the Creator. He is God in the flesh. That's the first part about the identity of Jesus we need to know. The second is that he's fully human. I don't know if you've seen a doctor recently. I see the doctor occasionally when I need to. I'm not the sort of person that just goes for a checkup because I've got a bit of spare time. But when I go to the doctor, it's because you're thinking you have plenty of problems. You should see them all the time. But I go to the doctor. I have a problem, and I like it when she shows me empathy. Right? Isn't that good? You go to the doctor, and they say, "Wow, that splinter must really have hurt, Bruce. Are you okay? Do you want a hug?" You know, they don't say that. But you know, it's nice to get that empathy. But I need more than that, don't you? When you go to the doctor, you need more than that, don't you? You need an answer. You need something to do. You need a response. You need a fix. That sounds bad, doesn't it? I'll go to the doctor for my fix. You know, you need whatever you need. You need something to address the problem. You can't walk out of the doctor's surgery with the doctor saying, "Well, I don't really know. I'm not going to do anything, but I feel for you." That's not enough. So when Jesus came to earth, the first thing we think of, he became human. So here is God in the flesh. He knows what I feel. He knows what it is to be tempted. He knows what it is to lose a friend. He knows what it is to experience joy. He was human. God has empathy for us. He experienced what we experience. That's great, and it is true, and it's all good, but it's not enough. Not enough just to have the empathy of God to say, "Hey, I've been there, done that, you'll be right. Go home and have a nice rest." We need God to actually do something. And what he did in coming to earth in the flesh was not just to say, "Hey, I'm one of you now." He said, "I've got a solution." And he did something. He dealt with the problem that we have of sin and death. He dealt with it. And have a look at this. We're going to look at Galatians 4. So just flick forward to Galatians chapter 4. Page 1170. It's like an FM radio station. 1170. Galatians 4, verse 4. Let me put it up on the screen as well. It's like, what are they bother looking it up for? Yeah. "But when the set time had fully come, God sent his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those under the law, that we might receive adoption to sonship. When the time came, God sent his son, born of a woman, under the law, to redeem those under the law." I brought something. I'll need this. I'll need some. Oh, look at that camera work happening already. This is very exciting. It's my jelly. Can you see it? Oh, look at that. How good's that? Good work. All right. I want you to imagine this is the world we live in, the green jelly. We live in the green jelly. This is the world under the law. And we are people. I found a Lego man. There wasn't many in our house anymore, but there he is. This is us. And we are in. Oh, it looks good, doesn't it? Juicy. See, now I put my fingers in it. No one else will touch it. It's my jelly. Can we get closer on that? Oh, yes. Look at him, that poor little man. That's us. We are not only in the world, but we are in the covenant of the law. And we are stuck there. We are in a place where the law holds us as a slave. And God wants to give us the inheritance of the kingdom of heaven. But we can't get out because we're stuck under the law and we can't obey the law to get out of the law. And so we're stuck in there. And so God comes in the person of Steve, no, of Jesus. So he's got a square head. I don't know if you can see him there. Here we go. This is Jesus. God enters our world. He enters the world of that is under the covenant of the law. He becomes one of us. And he enters that. But here's the difference. Jesus, you see, he fulfills all the requirements of the law. I'm trying to get my action down here so you can see it. He fulfills all the requirements. So Jesus can emerge out of this when he pleases and go back in and come back out, right? He's okay because he's not trapped by the law because he's fulfilled the law. He's met all the requirements of the law. What Jesus does is say, you know what? I'm going to fulfill the requirements of the law for you as well. I'm going to enter your world. I'm going to pay for your sin and I'm going to, oh, this is the tricky part, I'm going to drag you out of it and cleanse you from all that goop. And he brings us out. And you see what happens now? We are under his guardianship instead of the guardianship of the law. Can I say, green jelly smells horrible. It's really yuck. Don't eat it. Don't eat that. This is what Jesus does. He enters our world and pulls us out of the guardianship of the law and brings us under his guardianship. And he says, I want to give you now the kingdom of heaven. And you can have it if you hold on to him. I really should have brought tissue up here. There's not one. Anyway, that was ill thought out. It's all right. I'll be all right. Exciting. Living dangerously. Galatians 4 tells us we have an inheritance from God, the kingdom of heaven. We have that inheritance, but we are in the law. We are under the guardianship of the law, and we haven't fulfilled the law. We haven't met the requirements, so we can't have the inheritance that God wants us to have. And so Jesus enters, and he's completely obedient to the law. He fulfills all the requirements of the law. Oh, thanks. That's awesome. He fulfills all the requirements of the law and lifts us out of that. Isn't that awesome? It's the only way it could have happened. Someone from outside our world comes into our world and meets all the requirements that we should have met but couldn't meet. I was speaking to a lawyer once that deals with inheritances for families often. And he said it often gets quite heated when the will is sort of read out and the family realises what's going on. He said sometimes the parents will die and leave an inheritance to just one of their three or four children, just to one of them, usually the one child who has looked after them really well. So all you children sitting here with older parents, you know, think about that. But he said it gets quite heated because the other children, obviously, they contest the will because they want an equal share in the inheritance, even though they don't deserve it. They haven't been good children. There was one child that's been good and the others have just want the equal inheritance. And why should they? Jesus is the good son. Jesus is the one that was obedient to the Father. Jesus is the one that met all the requirements of the law. And we are the adopted children who don't deserve any inheritance at all. But Jesus came into our world so we could have the inheritance with him. God came flesh so we could call him brother as well as Savior. So we could have the same share of the eternal kingdom of heaven that Jesus has. Isn't that amazing? We didn't do anything to deserve it. It's an act of love. It's an act of grace. It's God choosing to come into our world and rescue us. Can we flick back to John chapter 1 again? By what Jesus has done, he's actually given us the real inheritance. A full inheritance. A child's inheritance that we don't deserve. I can't remember what page it's on. It's the New Testament, right? 1062, that's right. 1062. Let me read this first. John chapter 1, verse 12. Yet to all who received him, that is, they grabbed onto him when he entered our world, those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Doesn't that blow your mind? That not only don't we deserve it, but he gives us the right to the inheritance. This is the work of the Son, that he had to be fully God to have the power over sin. He had to be fully human to enter our world and pull us out of it. And that's what he did. Greg spoke last week about God the Father. You know, that illustration of a child jumping out of a tree and the father stepping back and the child falling to the ground. God does not do that. Our God is the God who steps forward, who steps towards us and grabs hold of us. What can I say? Jesus is the way he steps forward. Jesus is the way God steps forward to us, to take hold of us, to step into our world and to pull us out of this one. I want to finish by introducing another passage, which I don't usually do, but it's an important one. And again, I'd love for you to turn to it because you may find it impossible to put down after you start reading it. It's from Colossians chapter 2. It's on page 1183. 1183. Probably won't be able to stop reading the chapter because it's so good. Colossians is the book where all of our vision, our mission statements for our church come from, by the way. It's a really great book. Incredible. In fact, I think the vision statement for AFES also comes from Colossians to present people mature in Christ. Let me read this verse for you from verse 9 and 10. For in Christ all the fullness of the deity lives in bodily form. And in Christ you have been brought to fullness. It's a simple but a big idea. In Jesus, all the fullness of God is in him. The fullness of the Father, the fullness of the Spirit, the fullness of the Son is all in Jesus. And through him, you have been brought to fullness. See, he dived into our world and grabbed you and pulled you into the fullness of God if you hold on to him. If you held on to him. You know that feeling after a big meal, a really good meal, you just feel full? Just a good amount of full, not sick full, right? And then dessert comes out. Say, I got room for that. And you put that in. And you just, now I'm full. You know that second full? Now I'm full. And you have some dessert, it's like, now I'm full. Again, not that full that I need to throw up, but I'm just full. Just the right amount. What does that mean? What is that feeling? Have you ever thought, why am I full? Because you don't need anything more, right? You don't need anything more. That's what it means to be pulled into the fullness of God, is that you don't need anything more. That's where Jesus brings you to. When he enters your world and pulls you out under the curse of the law and sin and death, he pulls you into the fullness of God, which means you no longer need anything. Your eternity is set. You don't need to worship other gods anymore. So put them away. God is all we need. And Jesus is the one that pulls us out of this world and brings us into that state. It's an amazing thing. God was willing to step forward, get his hands dirty, plunge into our cesspool of a world and pull us out of it, having fulfilled all the requirements that we could never fulfill. I'm going to leave it there. I'm going to pray. And then I think if you like, we can answer maybe one or two questions if you have one. Well, you could ask them, and I could see if I could answer them. But I really want us to walk away from here just being a little bit more deeper in our heart of who God is and what he's done for us in the person of Jesus. Let me pray. Heavenly Father, thank you that you have come to our world. You've become us. You've become a human, yet with a significant difference, that you remain God. You've rescued us from a world that we were trapped in, that we were slave to. You've pulled us out, not just out of that, but into the fullness of the deity, into your fullness. And we need nothing else. Father, I pray that perhaps is the one truth we can walk away with tonight above anything, that we don't need anything else, that we don't need to worship other gods, whether it's other people or professions or careers or money or wealth or power or whatever it might be, that we don't need to worship those things because we are completely full through you. Amen. Do you have a question? Come on up, James. Background music for questions. How exciting is that? Do you have any questions? Would you like to ask one? Yes, Sarah. Hang on, I'll just give you a microphone. Otherwise, I'll be repeating it and I might get it wrong.
So in one of the creeds, it says that the Son is begotten of the Father, which kind of sounds like he comes from the Father.
Mm.
But then there's other creeds that say not created or something. So I'm just wondering why that creed doesn't say that Jesus was not made.
Yeah, yeah. So all the creeds we say, we have an Apostles' Creed, that's the most common one we say, the Nicene Creed, which is a longer one, there's an Athanasian Creed, there's all sorts of creeds. And a lot of creeds were written around the problems, the heresies of the church at the time. And so there were heresies that were saying that Jesus came from the Father, so he was less than the Father, and then the Spirit came and the Spirit is less than the Son. And that's a particular heresy of the church that had to be sort of stopped. So they wanted to make sure they knew that the Father, Son, and Spirit were all equal. There was not one that was greater than the other. There's not one that's more powerful. But there's an obedience there. The Father obeys the Son obeys the Father. The Spirit obeys the Son. There's an order to the Godhead, but not one of importance. There's an order of obedience. It's a beautiful thing. And so when we say that Jesus is the begotten Son, he was born, so he wasn't made. In some of the creeds it says he proceeds from the Father. And the Holy Spirit says the Holy Spirit proceeds from the Father and the Son. So this procession, in a procession, the person at the front isn't better, they're not more important, they're not more powerful, they're just in order. And so the idea of God is he's a God of order. He wants us to understand this relationship in an ordered way. He sent the Son. And you notice in John 14, Jesus says to his disciples, I'm leaving now, I'm going to send you a counselor. Jesus sends the counselor. This is an order. It's not one of importance. So the creeds, very important to hear the words as we say them, and we'll maybe rotate them around a bit more often at church on Sundays too. But there's heresies that sneak in where we give, God the Father is bigger than God the Son. But they're not. They're the same. They were there from the very beginning. One in three, three in one. Hope that answers it a little bit. Thanks for the question. It's a great question. Any other questions? Yes. Sure. Okay, thanks, Beck. The word was a God. Yes, the Jehovah's Witnesses translate the Bible that way, and that really does reek of separating Jesus as a separate God or a separate divinity, and we are people who believe in one God. So it's the bottom line is it's a false translation from the Greek to say a God. The definite article, the, is there, so he is the God, the one and only God, not to be separated, not to be confused. So, and yes, the certain Bibles that other sects put out, S-E-C-T-S, put out, they do change the translation to one that is just not sustainable. And so, yeah, that's a good question. So these are things, this is salt and sugar. This is what matters. These sort of things matter. It matters that Jesus is God, the one God, the indefinable, but the one, only God. Did you have a second question? Did you say? No?
Bad to like take up so many questions. Please.
Well, I'm not seeing competition, so you know, go for it.
I'll be quick then. Does Jesus share his inheritance with us, or does he enable the Father to give inheritance to us, and does it matter?
That's a lovely question. That's a really lovely question. Does Jesus share the inheritance with us? Well, I mean, you can only share an inheritance, can't you? There's only one inheritance. It's the kingdom of heaven. And so Jesus doesn't give us the opportunity to have some inheritance. He just says, you're with me. So we come under his guardianship, and he chooses to share that inheritance with all of us. So again, when Jesus plunges into our world, he offers, you know, hang on for your life. And if we do hang on to him, we share in the inheritance. Yeah. And hence we can call Jesus our Lord, our Savior, our Teacher, our Master, but also our Brother. Which is, again, a beautiful way to think about who God is and how he plunges to the depths to be in a relationship with us. One more? Yeah. She go. Mm-hmm. Mm. Yeah. That's it. John 14.
I think it's John 14, I think.
Yes.
So.
Yes. So the big question here is what does he mean by when he says the Father is greater than I? That word greater is talking about, and again, this is a really big discussion, but it's not talking about he's better or he's bigger or he's more powerful. It can't be those things because they are the one. But Jesus is recognizing obedience. So if you think about a good relationship between a father and a son, for example, on earth, the son would be obedient to their father, right? Okay, that's a good thing. And the father would be seen as the head of that relationship in that sense. But in a sense, they're still humans. They're still equal. So Jesus recognizes God as the one who directs the things that are happening. So like a teacher and students in a classroom, the teacher has that authority, but they're no greater than the students. They're no better than the students, but they have that position. That's a really, The big tumble-down effect of that is that people will take one verse like that without all the other verses in the Bible and say that Jesus is less than the Father and the Spirit is less than Jesus. And so you end up with this really messy idea of the Trinity. Thanks, that's a really good... I'm going to look up some more on that one, though, because the... Yeah, always when you get an English translation, it's like, oh, that's a weird choice of word. It often is a weird choice of word, so thank you. We'll leave it there. Hey, if you've got more questions, I'd love to talk to you after the service. And Greg's here as well. He was here, preached last week on the Father. I know he wanted to have a question time and wasn't sure if he had time, so I said, oh, why not? So we're going to sing again as we conclude our service together. What's our last song? I praise the name. What a great way to honour God. So let's stand, let's praise his name as our great Heavenly Father who is in all power over us.
Savior, who wrought the curse of the tree.
You may be seated. When Bruce was saying that time didn't exist, I thought he was going to preach for an hour. Because I know that he loves talking about Jesus, and so many of us do. And so just encourage you, if you've got questions about Jesus, you want to know more, please do let someone know. And if you're feeling a bit shy about it, you can even just fill out a connect form and let the ministry team know, and someone can follow up later. But we don't want anyone leaving and having these questions and not feeling the courage to speak up and ask. So please do. I'm just going to pray as we close out the service. Dear Lord, thank you for the time that we've had together tonight. Thank you for the gift of unity and salvation that's revealed through Jesus. Thank you for adopting us, even though we're sinners and haven't done anything to deserve your love. May we live each day in the hope of eternal inheritance that you have prepared. And may the knowledge of Jesus impact our lives every day and completely satisfy us. Amen. I just want to finish off with 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 14. It says, may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Hope everyone has a blessed week, and we'll see you next week. Thank you.